Welcome to the Rally for Religious Liberty. Welcome to Iowa, some of you that aren't from Iowa, but the vast majority of you are from Iowa, and we want to say thank you for coming out tonight, joining with us to rally for religious liberty. This is a serious topic that we're gathered around tonight. It's this topic that really is at the root of the foundation of the very country that we call home. Most of us, many of us, are descendants of people who left other countries generations ago to escape religious persecution, to come to a country where they could celebrate religious freedom, where our families could worship God in a way that was not mandated by the government, that was not controlled by somebody else outside of their own conscience and their own understanding of what God called them to do and to live the sort of life that God called them to live. We live in a country that was handed to us by those patriots that took great risks to leave their homes and to come to America. They gave us a place where we could raise families like the one you just saw. Weren't the Bontrager family singers great? If you're like me, when you watch those young people sing and play and use their gifts to glorify God, it gives you hope for the future. And tonight, as we come together, we are going to talk about some serious subjects. You're going to meet some people who have experienced things that our forefathers would never have believed could possibly happen in America. You're going to hear stories that I think will cause your heart to perhaps skip a beat when you realize this is actually happening in the United States of America. And yet we still have the freedom to come together and in Jesus' name gather like the Bontragers just did, sing patriotic songs, and to also elevate the name of their Lord and Savior. And ultimately, that is why we're doing what we're doing. Not just tonight, but why we have been engaged in this discussion about religious liberties for a long, long time. And you're gonna hear from folks who had a point in time where their conviction about the exercise of religious liberty came in conflict with their government. And yet I think what you're gonna find is with each individual, with each story, this is something that is an ongoing, long-standing component of who they are as individuals. Because it's not just the point in history or the point in time where you're confronted and required to make a decision. Will I stand on my principles? Will I defend my faith? Or will I obey a mandate from some authority figure that's calling me to violate those convictions? It's not that point in time where you make that decision. It's every day that leads up to that experience. And it's your consistent walk and your consistent practice and the education that you've likely had from your parents, your grandparents, and that sort of thing that creates the sort of character that causes you, when you become confronted with that situation, to say, I cannot violate what God's called me to do. And so tonight, As we hear these people's stories, as we share in their experience, I want to make sure that you don't miss the point. And the point of a lot of what you're going to see tonight is that their story is your story. The only difference is perhaps it hasn't happened to you yet. But when you hear these stories, and as you think about, what would I do in that situation? Internalize that very question, because you are likely to be faced with that situation. In fact, I would venture to guess that many of you have in one way or another. Maybe it's the sensitivity training that your work requires you to go through. And you just think, boy, if I just am quiet enough and get through this, I can just go back to work and do what I need to do. Maybe it's somebody who comes and goes from a civic club or a social environment where they're vocal about their beliefs, and you have to decide, will I tell the truth or will I just be quiet? And will I step back and will I let this opportunity go? And so I want you to understand that their story is your story. This is not a time to gather thousands of people together to come in and just observe, to be entertained, or to be here to just lift them up. And we want to lift you up tonight. We want to acknowledge that the sacrifices that you have made as you tell your stories are very real and very inspiring to us. But if when we leave tonight, we just heard some stories from some people that we really admire, we've kind of missed what was going on here, because their story is your story. And ultimately, their story and your story is important, in part because in America, we ought to be able to own and conduct a business in accordance with our faith. We ought to be able to hold a public job and conduct ourselves in accordance with our faith. We ought to be able to provide a service in accordance with our faith. And the reason that it's important that you and I stand together with these folks and folks like them all over the country is not just because their livelihood is threatened, not just because they're closing their businesses and being forced to comply with laws that are in conflict with their religious convictions, but because ultimately at the base of that is that each one of us is called to share our faith with others. And when confronted with those situations, whether it's somebody that walks into your shop or whether it's the encounter that you have at your place of business or the company that you work with, each of those is an opportunity for you to not just say, this is what I believe based on God's word, but that conversation then opens the door for you to look that person in the eye and say, you and I have a shared situation. You and I have a common place in that we are both sinful humans. We were both born with a sin nature and in need of a Savior. And in this country, we still have the ability to share our faith freely, but it's being threatened. If it becomes criminal, which it has in these folks' case, if it becomes criminal to say, I care enough about you that I want to live out my faith in a way that would help you to understand that there's sin in your life. I mean, I presume there are many believers in the audience tonight. And you would not be there in that place, you would not be in that relationship with your God if you hadn't come to a position where you understood that you were lost, that you were lost in your sin, that eternity is a really long time, hell is a really hot place, and you really never want to go there. And somebody cared enough about you to share the love of Jesus Christ and to say, there is a Savior who cared enough to die for you, that God sent His Son to take your sin on Himself, to die in your place, and to demonstrate His power over sin and death by rising again. If it had been illegal for somebody to say that, how much smaller might our numbers be? And the reason that we still live in a country that is blessed in the many ways that we are, I believe, is because our founders, in amongst all the rights that they itemized in our Constitution, in the principles that are outlined in all of our founding documents, in the early speeches and writings, they came from what those founding fathers learned from their preachers. In fact, many of them were preachers. And so if we look at the Bontrager family as an example, or the many young people that are sitting out here tonight, and we think we want for them a brighter future than what we had, just like our parents wanted a brighter future for us than they had, the key, the linchpin, the focal point for being able to do that throughout our history as a country has been preserving our religious liberties. Keep in mind, if for some reason a government or a court can take away our religious liberties, can take away our First Amendment rights, what's to stop them to take the Second Amendment or any other right? Our rights come from God, not from the government. Tonight you're going to meet some great patriots. You're going to meet some folks who are examples of average, everyday, ordinary people who certainly wouldn't have imagined that one night they would be sitting here telling you their story. And yet when the time for choosing came, they chose their Lord and Savior over compliance with a court or with the government. My hope is that as we go through this evening and when we come to the conclusion of this evening, that you have identified enough with their stories that in your heart and in your mind, you're prepared to say, when it comes my turn, I am going to stand with them and I'm going to stand with my God no matter what the government says. As we get started tonight, we want to invite a local pastor to come and just lead us in prayer. Mike Damascus is a pastor who's become a good friend of mine over the years. He's someone who pastors a smaller church, but they have an influence that is far larger in this community than their numbers would imply. And part of the reason for that, I believe, is that Pastor Mike is unafraid. Pastor Mike is one of those guys that is just bold. He knows what he's called to do, and he goes and does it and lets the world see him live out his faith. I'm going to invite him to come and tell a little bit of his story and to share an experience that he had as he preached on the subject that is kind of at the center of our discussion this evening, and then to lead us in prayer. And so, Pastor Mike, if you would, please.
It warms my heart to see all of you here tonight. I am really honored to be able to be a part of this experience and to say that I early on was able to say, Mr. Cruz, I'm with you all the way. I believe in his ability to articulate conservative principles, and I know that he's going to fight and champion what we believe in. And so that's why it's easy for me to get behind a guy like that, and I'm honored to be able to be here with you. But what I know is there's coming a day when a pastor standing behind a pulpit preaching the whole counsel of the Word of God is going to be seen and deemed as a threat. And I pray that every pastor continues to preach God's Word unfiltered, unadulterated, just from the pulpit as loudly and boldly and courageously as they can. Because that is the only thing that will turn this country around again. So I'm going to ask you if you're physically able to stand with us as we address a righteous and holy God this evening to begin. Father God, we thank you so much for who you are, the blessings that you have given to this great nation that we are a part of. You have said that blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, and we have turned our back on you. Forgive us, God. We repent, but there are people here, thousands across our land that say, we want our country back. And so, God, we just cry out to you and say, Lord, help us stand firm in the torrent that is before us. And I thank you, God, for the people that will be here, the examples that we see of courage and conviction in a culture that is so compromised. Help us, God, to never turn our backs on Jesus. Help us to always stand for truth. We pray this prayer and your blessing tonight in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
I was thinking as we were getting ready for this event about my kids and the sort of world that we're going to leave to them. The sorts of discussions that we've had around the dinner table a generation ago you never would have imagined having. A parent talking to his son, not just explaining the biblical truths that I want my sons to operate by, but to then have to discuss the nature of our political environment and the society that we are currently living in, and explaining to them, this is God's truth, and when you say this publicly, you are likely to come under persecution or pressure. And what Pastor Mike didn't say, and I'll tell you for him, he put up a title of a message on his marquee that dealt with sin. And the folks that were convicted by that sign vandalized the sign, threatened him and his family, called the news. Amazing, a pastor is preaching on sin. And the news, people thought it was newsworthy. I thought that was kind of interesting too. And Mike saw just a little glimpse of what some of our special guests tonight have been through. And so as I think about my kids, I think, wow, how amazing that we've come to a point where I have to have these discussions with my kids. And then it causes me to think about my parents, my grandparents, my great-grandparents. And I'm probably not that different than a lot of you. Is there anybody else in here who's a granddaughter or grandson of the Revolution? Somebody whose family was here early enough that your family was a part of the Revolution? I'm seeing hands. Keep those hands up. How about folks who either fought in, or your parents or grandparents fought in World War I or World War II? Look at all the hands. How many folks have got family members that are either currently deployed or have been recently deployed in our current conflicts around the world? Hands up all over the room. Don't squander the sacrifices that have been made by our forefathers. Tonight I have the honor and privilege of introducing to you a friend of mine. He's somebody who's very familiar to a lot of you. I've spent many, many miles sitting next to him in a car looking through the windshield and discussing any number of things. All sorts of topics, both philosophical, religious, and of course political, came up in the discussions. And over the years, I learned to admire not just his political acumen, but his philosophical perspective and just his way of decompressing or dissecting an issue and boiling it down to not just the current day's state of affairs, but to relating it to our history as an individual or as a country. And so tonight, as we begin to lay the foundation upon which we're going to have this discussion with our special guests, I'd like to invite to the stage and introduce to you a good friend of mine and somebody who is a good friend to the state of Iowa, Congressman Steve King.
Thank you very, very much. It is an honor to be in this building, in this room, among all of you. And you treat me that well when I step out here, and I'm very grateful to have the privilege to say some things. And I want to compress it into a way that adds meaning to the balance of what you'll hear here tonight, and about religious freedom and the victims of the persecution. But first, I think we need to understand about this great country that we are. I profoundly believe God shaped this nation with his hand, and that he sent the pilgrims and the other settlers over here to this continent by many moved our founding fathers around like men on a chessboard to shape this great nation. And he did a lot of things in the many centuries before that to prepare the groundwork so we could be this great nation. And I would take you back to Mosaic Law. God sent Moses up the mount to come down with the tablets, Mosaic Law. Now, I would not know that many centuries later, I find myself wanting to hear the arguments before the Supreme Court on whether or not we had enough religious liberty to set the tablets up in places like Texas. And that was the month of June, as I recall, but it was a bright day, and in about 2005, I slipped over there to the Supreme Court building. I had a little permission slip from the justices to hear the oral arguments before the court. The crowd out front was so thick, the only way I could get to the front door was to climb through the hedge. A bright, sunny day, I climbed through the hedge. I go up to the door of the Supreme Court. My pupils are all shrunken down, as they are. Opened the door into the darkness. There stood a white shirt. That's all I could see. And I said, "I'm Congressman Steve King, here to hear the arguments on the Ten Commandments before the Supreme Court." And the man whom I couldn't see, only see his white shirt, he said in a deep voice, he said, "I'm Moses, and I'm here to lead you." No kidding. No kidding. And he's led me in since. Moses led me in, and Moses led me out. What I didn't know was that up in front of that courtroom was going to be the Solicitor General of the state of Texas. And that was 10 years ago. The Attorney General is now the Governor of the state of Texas. Solicitor General is now a United States Senator sitting in the front row here tonight as a candidate for the United States presidency. Now, I'm tempted to say the Lord works in mysterious ways, but I don't think it's that mysterious. I think it's obvious. And so I'm grateful that I've had that chance to connect this continuum of history. But I remember a Democrat state senator saying to me, "Why would you think that America is God-shaped by the hand of God, that it was His divine guidance?" And I believe it was His divine guidance that shaped America. He said there were deists, it was an accident of history, it's simply the evolution of the species of humanity, could have happened in some other planet someplace else in the universe. No, I can't accept that at all. Mosaic Law went to Greeks, and the Greeks thought they had law, but it actually came from Moses. And Roman law was what Jesus asserted when he stood before the high priest, when he said he had a right to face his accusers, and he was innocent until proven guilty. Remember when he said to the high priest, said Caiaphas? He said, "Jesus, did you really preach those things? Did you say those things?" And Jesus said, "Ask them." And he pointed to his accusers. "Ask them, they were there." And the guard struck Jesus for his insolent answer. But the answer was, he had a right to face his accusers. And then Jesus said, "If I have spoken wrongly, you must prove the wrong. But if I've spoken rightly, why do you punish me? Innocent until proven guilty." Flows from Mosaic Law through the Greeks, through Roman law, which was spread all across Western Europe. There, the birth of Christ gave us redemption and all the wonderful things that we know that came from Jesus that flows out of the Spirit within us to this day. That all was a foundation laid across Western Europe with Roman law. Went into the Dark Ages. They forgot how to think for a few centuries. They brought that back again because the Bible was protected and preserved, and they had to relearn how to think. But there was the foundation of free enterprise capitalism that was published in 1776 by Adam Smith that came over here to this country too. And we had the Puritans. We had a concept of manifest destiny to settle this continent from sea to shining sea at the dawn of the Industrial Revolution with unlimited natural resources. And we did so in the blink of an historical eye. And we became the unchallenged greatest nation in the world. How could anybody think that that's not the hand of God? And did they understand that then? Our founding fathers did. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their creators with certain unalienable rights. We know they knew that. They wrote that down and placed their lives, their fortunes, and their sacred honor on it. But 1865, February 12th, the Civil War wasn't over. It was Lincoln's last birthday on Sunday. The first black person allowed to speak in the United States Capitol building, when members of Congress believed that Lincoln had just freed the slaves shortly, well before, a little before that, and they believed that they should have a sermon and a religious service there, and they invited Reverend Henry Highland Garnett to deliver that sermon in the United States Capitol. And I've taken just some excerpts from it. It takes about 40 seconds, but I think it's really important to hear how a former slave then pastor of the 15th Street Presbyterian Church, February 12, 1865. With his background, he understood and he spoke to the members of Congress this religious freedom. He's speaking of the founding fathers. They have received from the court of heaven the Magna Carta of human rights that was handed down through the clouds and amid the lightnings of Sinai and given again by the Son of God on the Mount of Beatitudes while the glory of the Father shone around them. They tell us that from the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution, they have obtained a guarantee of their political freedom, and from the Bible, they derive their claim to all the blessings of religious liberty, freedom to worship God. I recommend that you Google Reverend Henry Highland Garnett and read that entire hour and a half long speech. Put yourself in the mindset of that place and that time, Lincoln's last birthday, near the end of the Civil War, and the abolitionists and the freedom that a freed slave understood about rights coming from God, and think, do our children know this? Will our grandchildren learn this? Will we know that this culture, this civilization must understand the principle that rights come from God? If they come from government, government can take them away. They're unalienable. And I challenge all of us, step up and defend your rights that come from God, that are enshrined in the Declaration and the Constitution. Be not afraid. Be bold. Be noble. Step up to the pulpit and preach the word. And if they come along and take away your 501c3 not-for-profit status, was anybody in this for a profit anyway? Why would you fear the IRS? And if you want a little help, call me. I'm there in spirit. I'll pray with and for you. And if you want me there physically, I'll come stand next to you. I don't need to stand next to you. I know you're there and you're bold. But we've got to be confident. And I recall a time when I was giving a speech out on the courthouse in Sioux County, Iowa. And an individual came out from the courthouse and he said, you can't speak here. This is electioneering. We have elections here in November. And State Representative Dwayne Alon said, well, if you can't exercise your right here on the courthouse lawn, can you tell me, where in the world can you? So I'm glad that we are standing here today, that we're going to hear these stories and these narratives and continue with that. I'm glad we have a leader who has stepped up for our religious freedom, defended the words under God, Hobby Lobby, the Ten Commandments, over and over again, the Boy Scouts. That all came from Ted Cruz. And he's brought us here together here tonight to pray and to learn and to go out of here energized to step up and defend our constitutional rights. If we don't use them, we will lose them. Thank you very much. Oh, and I'm going to introduce also, there'll be a video that follows me, Kelly Shackelford, who is another top attorney out of Texas, and he heads up the Liberty Institute, one of the top constitutional lawyers in our country. He's going to talk to you a little bit about religious liberty and defending religious liberty. Thank you very much. God bless you all. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Kelly Shackelford, and I've been doing religious liberty cases for over 26 years. I have to be honest with you. In the over quarter century that I've been fighting for religious freedom, I've never seen anything like what I'm seeing right now. This survey of attacks on religious freedom, over 1,600 published attacks, not even including the ones that aren't published, is an example of what is happening each year. The numbers of attacks are in fact proliferating, even doubling from one year to the next. Cases include everything from a little 5-year-old girl praying over her meal who was ordered by a school official to stop and told, quote, it is not good to pray at school, to a case where senior citizens were threatened with having their meals taken away because they were praying over their federally funded meals, and federal officials said that that would violate separation of church and state. The attacks are on people from the north, the south, from the east, the west, people of wealth, people of no resources at all, people who are young and people who are older. The attacks are pervasive. Tonight alone, you will hear from pastors who have been fined and had their chapel closed because they wouldn't engage in acts in violation of their faith. You'll hear from a couple who've had their business destroyed and a $250,000 fine assessed against them because they would not participate in a wedding that would violate their faith. You'll hear from a 72-year-old grandmother who might lose her home because she won't violate her faith and her conscience. You'll even hear from an Air Force veteran and a hero who gave his all for his country for over 19 years, only to be attacked for his faith, relieved of his duties, putting his entire career and even his pension in jeopardy. The stories you will hear are from ordinary citizens, and they are a wake-up call to a nation. Our founders called religious freedom our first freedom. They did so not just because it's in the first two clauses of the First Amendment, but because they knew that if you lose your religious freedom, you will lose all your freedoms. There is no better person to host this topic than Ted Cruz. I'm not saying this because his father is a pastor. I'm not even saying this because many know of Ted's brilliance, his many arguments before the U.S. Supreme Court, and his constitutional expertise. I'm saying this because of something few know. Way before Ted ever considered running for office, he was giving his time for religious freedom. Ted donated hundreds of thousands of dollars of time for religious liberty cases. This was a great sacrifice in time and money, but he did it because it is a priority and a commitment. When the Mojave Desert Veterans Memorial Cross was attacked by the ACLU, Ted donated his time to stand with me and with Liberty Institute in representing millions of veterans from the American Legion, the VFW, the Military Order of the Purple Heart, and American ex-prisoners of war. When the case went to the Supreme Court, this 70-year-old memorial, which had been put up by the hands of World War I veterans themselves, was ordered to be torn down by the lower courts and to be covered while the case went on appeal. The memorial, the cross, was actually covered with a bag, and then a chain was wrapped around the bottom with a padlock. At the U.S. Supreme Court, we were able to reverse the decisions below. The bag is off, the memorial's back up, and it was in part because Ted Cruz gave his tremendous talent, free of charge, to millions of veterans. The U.S. Supreme Court cited our brief over and over in its decision. If anyone has the background, the commitment, and the understanding to cover this issue, it is Ted Cruz. I am very thankful for him as a friend, a brilliant constitutional lawyer, and as a leader protecting our first freedom. God bless you, Ted Cruz, and thank you for hosting this very important rally.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome back to the stage, Brian English.
One of the things that Ted Cruz has got the ability to do is to put together an interesting team of folks from a variety of backgrounds. And tonight I want to introduce to you another patriot, another person who's been in a position of leadership here in the state of Iowa, somebody who many of you know, and I think that after you've heard him speak here a few minutes, are all going to love. And so I'd like to introduce to you the state chairman for our campaign here in the state of Iowa, former Secretary of State Matt Schultz.
It's an honor to be here with you tonight. It's even a bigger honor to serve as Ted Cruz state chair. I love this man. And let me tell you why. Because he's honest. He's honest and he stands up and he fights for what he believes in and what we believe in. We're at a crossroads in our country. We see the erosion of our families. Our Constitution's being shredded. The media cares more about the life of Cecil the Lion than they do the unborn. I'm married and I have five kids, and I am deeply concerned about where our country's going. We need a champion, a courageous conservative, someone who's going to stand up and fight for us. You know, I think about our Savior when he went to the temple and saw the money changers. What'd he do? He threw them out. We need someone who's going to go to Washington and throw the money changers out and stop the Washington cartel. When you read the scriptures, And when you look at our country's history, you can see that God prepares and raises special men and women to protect and fight for his people. And I believe this is one of those moments in time. Ted Cruz is that man who God has prepared for this moment in time to be our champion, to fight for our husbands, our wives, our children, and our grandchildren, for our country. Ted Cruz will restore our Constitution. He will restore our belief in America. That's why I'm supporting Ted Cruz. And that's why I'm asking each and every one of you to stand with me and other courageous conservatives in supporting my friend, our special senator who's here with us tonight, Texas Senator Ted Cruz. Let's give him a warm welcome.
God bless the great state of Iowa. You know, the word tells us where two or more are gathered in his name, he will be with us. What an incredible gathering this is from across this state. How honored and humbled I am to be standing with so many patriots here in this room and with so many heroes who have gathered to tell us their tale of courage. You know, this nation we love is unique in the annals of the history of the world. We are a nation that was founded by men and women fleeing religious oppression, fleeing kings and monarchs who would oppress them, who would tell them who you may worship and who you may not. And men and women fled from all over the world to come to the new world, to seek out a land where every one of us could worship the Lord God Almighty with all of our hearts, minds, and souls, free of the government getting in the way. Our nation was founded with a bloody revolution. A bloody revolution that, under ordinary reason, had no business succeeding. A hapless group of colonists declared war on the mightiest army on the planet. And yet, with God's providential blessing, America prevailed. But there was a second revolution, a revolution more important than the revolution fought with guns and bayonets. The far more important revolution was the revolution of ideas. For millennia, man had been told that our rights come from kings and queens, handed down like crumbs, by grace of the monarch to be taken away by the whim of the monarch. Our country began with a fundamentally different proposition, that our rights do not come from government, they come from Almighty God. As the Declaration put it so powerfully, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, and that they are endowed not by a king, not by a queen, not even by a president. They are endowed by their creator. with certain unalienable rights, and that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. With those words, this nation sprung into existence. There is a reason why in the Constitution, in the Bill of Rights, the very first protection in the very first amendment of the Bill of Rights is the freedom of religion. If we cannot worship God, if we cannot live according to our faith and our dictates, all other liberties fade away. You know, Steve talked about the Ten Commandments case in Texas. Ten Commandments case in Texas concerned a monument that had stood there since 1961. Was erected, stood there for decades, disturbing nobody on the state capitol grounds, until an individual plaintiff, an atheist, a homeless man, walked past the monument and decided it offended him. And he filed a lawsuit seeking to tear down that monument. When that case went to the United States Supreme Court, when we argued that case, does anyone here know how many times in the courtroom of the United States Supreme Court the image of the Ten Commandments appears? 43 times. That's very good. Forty times the Ten Commandments are on the brass gates on the side of the courtroom. When you walk out of the courtroom, there are two large wooden doors, and on those wooden doors are two more images of the Ten Commandments. You cannot walk out of the courtroom without seeing the Ten Commandments directly in front of you. And those justices, when they heard the oral argument, right above their left shoulder, carved into the frieze, was Moses holding the Ten Commandments, looking down upon them. Now, we won that case. But we won it 5-4. Four justices were willing to order the state of Texas tear down that monument that has stood on the state capitol ground since 1961. We're one justice away. You want to know what this election is about? We are one justice away from the Supreme Court saying, every image of God shall be torn down. Thus saith man. You know, Kelly Shackelford talked about the Mojave Desert Veterans Memorial case. A lone white Latin cross, 7 feet tall, erected to honor the men and women who lost their lives in World War I. Once again, a plaintiff, the ACLU, came and sued. The plaintiff said the image of a cross cannot be seen on federal land. Here in Iowa, there's litigation concerning exactly that today. I will say this, the plaintiffs were right on one thing. The cross has power. I'll tell you, it was humbling, it was moving, it was incredible to represent 3 million veterans standing before the Supreme Court, and we won that case also. But once again, it was 5-4. Four justices were willing to say this monument to our veterans must be torn to the ground. Anyone who's visited Arlington Cemetery and seen row after row of tombstone with a cross or Star of David, honoring our soldiers who gave the ultimate sacrifice, we're one justice away from the Supreme Court saying we must tear those down. And you know, I have to say, These threats have been growing. They have been growing for decades. But never have the threats been greater to religious liberty than they are right now and here today. You know, many in the media say these threats don't exist. They're not real. Well, the purpose of this gathering is to put a name and a face to these heroes. The purpose of this evening is to tell their stories. You know, there's a reason Jesus spoke in parables. Because that's how we understand. That's what touches our heart. That's what moves us. So it is my hope that all of us gathered here today, all of the home parties, all of the churches that are watching online, that believers across this country will come to know and love these ordinary men and women who were living their lives. They didn't ask for conflict. They didn't ask for confrontation. And the government came after them and said, choose between your faith and obedience to government power. And they said, I follow a higher power, and that is God Almighty. And so in telling these stories, I want to start with one that many of you know already. Two residents of Iowa, Iowa's own Dick and Betty Odegaard. From Grimes, Iowa, they are an incredible couple, a couple I've gotten to know quite well. And I want to start simply by playing a video, and then we're going to invite at the same time Dick and Betty are going to come to the stage, and we're going to have an opportunity to have a conversation. But let's start the video. Dick and Betty Odegaard. Betty, Dick, thank you for the courage of your convictions. Thank you for telling your story. Let me ask you, why did you first begin hosting weddings in the church that the two of you own?
We love weddings. We loved that business. Loved to do the flowers, and we had a restaurant, and we had everything all in one location. We had some beautiful events.
And tell all of us what your faith means to you.
Everything. It goes to the core of our being, how we live our life.
When you first found out you were being sued, how did that impact the two of you?
Well, the whole event was devastating. Personally, it brought me down. I knew that the Gertz house would never be the same. And it was devastating.
Let me ask you what a cynic, what a skeptical person, what a secular person might say. Which is, why didn't you just give in? Why didn't you just agree to allow the same-sex wedding to be celebrated in the Gertz house?
We could not celebrate a sin. We could not take part in what we believe is a sin.
Well, I suppose the media would say it's just an easy thing to roll over and accept it, to embrace it, to say it's right. And yet your faith wouldn't allow you to do that.
Of course not.
So the litigation went on. for 18 months. And then you personally paid $5,000 to settle the matter. And has there been another wedding in the Gertz house since then?
No.
Our last wedding was November of last year. We simply had to get out of the business. We're at risk. It was well publicized what our faith was, or what our faith is, and we just could not take the risk and put our employees in that wedge.
And then earlier this month, you closed the business altogether.
July 31st.
Tell us about what that means to you to close this business, hosting weddings that you loved so much. Tell us what that means to the two of you.
This was my passion. This was our passion. We had worked for 13 and a half years to build this business, and we lived there 6 days a week and just loved it. So it's very difficult to close the doors and walk away. It's hard to pack up.
It looks much different preparing for an auction than it does preparing for a wedding.
Yeah.
And that's where we're at today.
So has that auction occurred yet? Or
October 3rd. October. Y'all come.
And you had a number of employees that worked for you in the flower business and the catering business and all of the businesses that helped host these weddings.
Exactly.
What happened to your employees?
They have to look elsewhere.
So the consequence of this, you've been driven out of business.
Right.
Absolutely.
Your employees have lost their jobs. Mm-hmm. And tell me about the public reaction.
Confusing, actually. We had a lot of supporters, and we cherish those folks. The interesting part about it is that many of those supporters didn't want to support us publicly. They didn't want to be seen supporting us out of fear of reprisal. I don't know. Have to talk to those folks. So that hurt. All of a sudden, we learned more about people than what we thought we knew. So.
Well, and I know a lot of ugliness and vitriol was directed at the two of you.
Unbelievable.
And that wasn't easy.
No. Never had experienced anything like that before. Some people are familiar with the words and expressions that come after you. But this was brand new to us, and it really took us by surprise. To be called a hater and a bigot, just overnight you become something you don't recognize yourself.
Well, and I know the terms that are used by those attacking you, both the political activists and also many in the media, attempt to characterize you and me and all of us as somehow intolerant. And yet, what is the tolerance that has been demonstrated to you for following a biblical teaching?
Exactly.
That marriage is one man and one woman.
Exactly. Right.
These two men who wanted to get married, there were other facilities where they could do that. Is that correct?
Of course.
But they wanted it in your church for you to celebrate their union.
That's right.
Let me say something to the two of you. I know this has been a very hard journey. I know Betty in particular, this has been
Don't make me
difficult.
Cry.
I'm not going to. But I want to say something. Scripture tells us that God has ordered our steps.
Oh, amen.
And I will tell you, I'm convinced you have gone down this journey. You have endured the pain. You have endured the attacks. You have endured the hatred precisely
put you where you are here today for such a time as this.
I know. I agree.
You know, Dick, you talked about not knowing where your friends are. But let me point out there are 3,000 Iowans here with you today.
Thank you.
And there are church groups and home groups all across Iowa, all across the country. There are believers lifting you up in prayer. And let me tell you, your faith, your courage, they inspire every one of us to stand with you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Gentlemen, please welcome to the stage, Brian English.
The Oatgards are a treasure here in Iowa. When the government said, you will comply and you will violate your religious convictions, they said no. And we're proud of them. But they're not alone, unfortunately, in being put into that situation. And tonight we're going to meet some other folks who have been in a similar situation. And the person that's going to visit with them is a good friend of mine that I'd like to introduce to you tonight. He's a man that has an amazing ability to communicate biblical truth and do it in a way that cuts through the noise of our environment, our society. And he does it in an environment that is often very hostile to the gospel. And so I'd like for you to welcome to the stage this evening a good friend, another treasure here in the state of Iowa, Steve Dace.
Now, I don't know if you guys have heard a rumor about this or not, but I've got a little bit of a reputation for being kind of fiery. What you're about to see is going to make you angry. It's going to fire you up. It's going to be righteous anger, but we have to remember that in our anger, we do not sin. Saul is traveling the road to Damascus to arrest and kill Christians, and he, of course, it's a famous story. He encounters the living God in the flesh, Jesus Christ, who stops him on the road. And he says, why are you persecuting my people? No, that is not what Christ says. He says, why are you persecuting me? And we must remember that this isn't about us, that this is about the God we serve. And the Saul that had that moment later writes these words, liars, thieves, fornicators, homosexuals, murderers will not inherit the kingdom of heaven. That's a very harsh teaching, but true. But then he stops and says, but such as once were some of you. All of us in this room, if we claim Christ as Lord, have been one of those people. That's why we needed a Savior. And just as he died for us and died for the heroes you're going to hear from here in a few moments, He also died for those that are on the other side of the persecution. He wants to redeem them as well. He made them as well. He counted the hairs on their heads as well. He knows the number of their days as well. Let us not forget that, because in the end, this isn't a political struggle. This is not an ideological struggle. This is a struggle for the soul. Now let's meet some people through this video who understand that. And when it was their turn to choose ye this day, made the right choice. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our heroes to the stage. All right, I know you guys are really nervous, so let's start with an icebreaker question, shall we? I want the six of you, raise your hand if you signed up to enlist in a culture war. Raise your hand. No? All right, so here's the reason I asked that question, ladies and gentlemen. We have bakers, a florist, shirt maker, military man, and a fireman. Everyday people. These are not people that majored in culture war at the seminary. They're not United States senators. These are just everyday people like all of you in this room. And yet they find themselves on the front line in the battle for the soul of this culture, for the very way of life. What kind of people ought we to be? And I think it's important as we begin our conversation with them that all of you in your seats right now that are enjoying your comfort and your air conditioning, that when you leave here, may go home to your farms, your businesses, your churches, and think this could not happen to you. I'd be willing to bet the six people up on the stage here tonight all thought the exact same thing as well, that this wouldn't happen to them and this could not happen here. I want to start with you, Chief Cochran, if I could. Give our audience an idea what it means to become a fireman. Why would you want to do that? What kind of training, discipline does it take to accomplish that goal?
Well, I was born in poverty in Shreveport, Louisiana in the early 60s, and I was one of six kids. We were living in a government project. My dad left my mother, and she raised all six of us by herself. We moved to an alley in a shotgun house, and one Sunday after church, we heard a siren outside of our house, and we sprang to our feet and opened the front door, and there was a big red Shreveport Fire Department fire truck in front of our house. Miss Maddie's house across the alley from us was on fire, and I was smitten on that day that I wanted to be a firefighter when I grew up, and there were three things that I thought about as a little kid. I wanted to be a firefighter, I didn't want to be poor, and I wanted a family because I realized how awful it was not to have a dad at home. The grown-ups told us that in America, all of our dreams would come true if we believe in and have faith in God, if we go to school and get a good education, if we respect grown-ups and treat other children like we wanted to be treated, then our dreams would come true. So they fed faith and patriotism into us growing up in Shreveport, Louisiana. And in 1981, my childhood dream came true. I became a firefighter. With 18 years in the department, I became the fire chief of the Shreveport Fire Department. In 2008, I was appointed fire chief in Atlanta under Mayor Shirley Franklin. After there for 20 months, I was appointed by President Obama to head the United States Fire Administration. And less than 1 year later, I was recruited back to Atlanta by the Honorable Mayor Kasim Reed and served him until January 6th of this year when I was terminated from employment from the Atlanta Fire and Rescue Department. So my childhood dream came true, fairy tale career ended in this year, 2015.
So Chief, you are the American dream. I mean, do you understand the story, ladies and gentlemen? You just heard, this is the American dream right here. I mean, you are a living embodiment of it. So if you lost your job, absolutely applaud that. So given all of the merit badges you've earned all the way through life, right? You clearly must have been derelict in your duty. You must have done something wrong in your job to cause you to be fired. Except that wasn't the case. In fact, you were fired for no reasons that had anything to do with your job, but for simply writing a book. Tell our audience about that.
About 3.5 years ago, I was conducting a men's small group Bible study at my church called The Quest for Authentic Manhood. And I asked the men, are men today still suffering from the consequences of what Adam did in the Garden of Eden? And of course, all of them said yes. And I asked them to tell me why. And as they talked, the question God asked Adam in the garden, who told you that you were naked, kept ringing over and over again in my head. So I was so curious, I began to research the word naked to see if God was asking him more than who told you that you don't have on any clothes. And I found out that naked meant condemned and deprived. And when I discovered that, I also researched the word clothed and found out that clothed meant redeemed and restored. And so Galatians 3:27 says, those who have been baptized in Christ have been clothed with Christ. And God told me the reason why that was such a curiosity to me is that there are too many Christian men, clothed men today, still acting like naked men. And I need to ask them today, who told you that you were naked? And that's what the book is all about. What got me in trouble, the part that got me in trouble was the fact that in the book I dealt with sexual challenges that Christian men have and spoke of biblical marriage and biblical sexuality, and that's what caused the trouble that led to initially my 30-day suspension without pay and subsequent termination from employment with the city of Atlanta.
What you just heard is an amazing story. Nothing wrong with his record at all, to the point that he is appointed to one of the highest posts you can be as a fireman. He's working literally for the President of the United States and for expressing his Christian viewpoint in print in his own private time. His own private time. Let that sink in for a moment. His own private time. He loses everything. Colonel Stutzman, let me bring you into the conversation next, because your story is very well known to our audience. A lot of them listen to my radio show, and I have done my best to make your story very well known. And all of your story is very well known to the people in this room. It's just flowers. All right, you're just selling flowers. What's the big deal? Why not just sell the flowers, Baronel? Especially because you've sold them to this client so many times. What's different about this time?
This time it was about a marriage between a man and a woman. When Rob came in and asked me to talk about his wedding, and I put my hands on his and I said, Rob, I'm sorry I can't do your wedding because of my relationship with Jesus Christ. And he said, I understand. And we talked about his mom, we talked about his engagement, we talked about why he decided to get married. He asked me for recommendations of another florist. I gave him three names of florists that I knew would do him a great job because I knew he wanted a beautiful wedding. And we hugged each other and Rob left. When I do a wedding, I put everything into it. And I couldn't do Rob's because it would dishonor Christ. It's part of you, it's what you make, it's what you create, it's what you celebrate. And
as much as I love Rob, I couldn't celebrate his wedding.
You've mentioned this customer by his first name, like you had a relationship, that you had something beyond just the normal customer-business relationship. Is that true? What's your relationship with Rob?
Rob had been my customer for over 10 years, and we had a great working relationship, and he would come in and pick out different vases and different containers that were usually a little weird, and he'd say, this is the event I want to celebrate, and do your thing. And that was awesome to me because I got to do something creative and out of the box and something that I knew that he would like. And it was a privilege to be able to do that for him. But again, I couldn't do his wedding.
So here we have a story, ladies and gentlemen, where this is a customer she had a personal relationship with. Despite their differences, she was happy to serve him. He asked her the one thing from her that she could not provide, and that is to violate her conscience and disobey Christ in order to serve him in this context. And because of that relationship, the good news is there's no need for Baronel to be here tonight. He went about his way, went to another florist and said, I respect differences. I believe in tolerance and diversity. So Baronel, thank you very much. That's not actually what happened with the story, you know. He went right out of there and reported her. Like a George Orwell novel. So much for that relationship. Another story here in our panel that I know a lot of you are familiar with, Aaron and Melissa Klein. People are very familiar with what happened to you and the court case and the fines. But I want, Melissa, I want you to share with the audience what you told us last night in a reception that we had, just kind of getting everybody a chance to get to know one another and get ready for tonight. And what it was like interacting with fellow believers and the support that you got from the community, or in some cases, the support that you did not get from people. Can you share that with the folks here in the audience tonight?
I would definitely say that on the good side, the support that we've gotten nationally and even internationally has been really great. We've had a lot of emails of saying, we support you, we are praying for you. On the downside, we've also gotten a lot of hate mail. We've gotten threats. We've gotten death threats.
Boy, nothing says tolerance like death threats, huh? I mean, I just feel that warm fuzzy. Can you guys feel that emanating here in the room? Go ahead, Melissa.
We get lately, which I don't know why lately, and because it's been, we're going on 3 years of going through this, we've been getting inappropriate things mailed to our P.O. box. And that's just really disheartening, it's just...
Disheartening is when people say, I support you, but... I know you said last night you've had a lot of those conversations to the point that people said, hey, I'm happy to give you my business, but I don't want people to know I'm doing business with you. Tell us about that.
Yeah, when we had the shop, we had lots of people that would come in and they'd be like, we're just so proud of you guys. We're so glad, that you're standing up for your faith. And then they'd want to order stuff. We want to support you. And then I'd always put my sticker on the box that said Sweet Cakes by Melissa, and it was a black sticker with, pink writing. And they'd ask me to not put that on the box. And so I sat there and I thought, if you're with me and you're standing with me, why can't you stand yourself? Mm-hmm. And so that...
That, to me, might be the most disappointing thing we're going to hear in this conversation. I'd have more respect for people who are just openly opposed and honest about it than we're with you, but we don't want to go public. We don't want to say anything. About a week ago, I interviewed Craig James, the former sportscaster, who lost his job with Fox Sports because of what he said, actually, ironically, in a debate with Senator Cruz. And all he did, now this is a gentleman that worked for 20 years doing college football broadcasting all over the country for major networks, and hundreds of people and crews that knew him traveled with him. And because of what he said in a political debate, somehow that disqualified him from being in sports broadcasting. And I asked him, I said, Craig, all the people you've worked with at all these networks nationwide, no one has stood up and said, hey, I know Craig James. He's not a hater. He's not a bigot. Maybe we disagree, but I've been on the road with him. I've spent time with him. I've seen him interact with his family. This is wrong. And he said to me, a lot of people have done this privately, Melissa Klein. A lot of people have sent me private notes, but they're all afraid if they speak up publicly, they will lose their jobs. At some point, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to have to make a decision. Whom do we fear more? The one that can take the jobs away or destroy the body, or the one who can destroy the body and cast the soul into hell? Whom do we fear more? Now, Aaron, I know you don't have too much fear, because I've read and seen numerous interviews with you. I mean, you're kind of like, bring it on, man. It's on like Donkey Kong, right? So, you know, my wife tells me whenever I face a lot of scrutiny from the same polite and tolerant people that you're dealing with, that it's always harder on her watching it go happen to me than it is when it happens to me. I just sort of view it as a cost of doing business in a way. But in your case, watching this happen and watching your wife and probably her life's dream, this business, watching this happen to her, how did that impact you?
It's something you never want to see happen. I mean, honestly, to watch not only something that she worked so hard on, but something we went into together to build this business up, watch it be taken away by the very government that was intended to protect your freedom. Watching it be destroyed by people who have no tolerance whatsoever. It might surprise a lot of you to hear that I was never in a court. I have yet to be in a court. This was a bureaucratic entity that was built from the ground up to do the very thing that has happened to us. It is something that does not recognize the Constitution. It is something that dictates a lot of the government as it sits right now. We're fighting for our religious freedom in a room filled with bureaucrats that don't recognize our constitutional freedoms from the beginning. Biases are the norm, and that's what we're fighting. And it's an uphill battle, and we need to all take a stand.
Blaine Adams, and I want to bring you into the conversation because you're the person on this panel who has won. You have fought for your freedoms, and you have won, pending an appeal. I want to make sure I get this quote correct. The judge in your case said, quote, to print shirts was based upon the message of the GSLO and not on the sexual orientation of its representatives or members, unquote. Tell our audience what exactly that means and why that was instrumental in your victory.
Sure. Well, first, just so I get this out, that we'll print for anybody. And that was our main message. It didn't matter what their belief system was or who they were, that it was really the message that if someone presents a message to me that conflicts with my beliefs, which contradicts with the Word of God, then for me, it's just, that's the line. It's just something that I can't print. And the judge, I think he got it right because he looked at the history of our company and we had rejected messages from different groups across the board if it conflicted with my faith, not just one specific group. We also had shown that we had worked with homosexuals and we would continue to work with homosexuals. So it was clear to the judge. He could see that it was about the message. It wasn't about who came in our door. And that was the point all along is, hey, I'll work with anybody, but not every message that's asked of me to print.
Folks, I hope you understand what Blaine just said, because he just really unlocked the Rosetta Stone to winning this argument. Because I know a lot of you are sitting in your seats and you're concerned, well, I don't want to discriminate against anybody. This isn't about discrimination. This is about whether someone, anyone, regardless of what they may be doing in their private lives or whether they go to church or not, can walk into your place of business or in your home, your private property, your intellectual property, and demand that you do things with it that violates your conscience. Can they demand that you perform a service for them? Let me put it in another context. Would we tell, for example, someone who was gay that owned a t-shirt company? Would we tell them that they had to print really just hateful screeds from Westboro Baptist Church? You have to do that. Would we tell them to do that? Would that be right? Would anybody in this room side with the idea that that is right? No. Even though we may disagree with the beliefs and the lifestyle of the gay t-shirt owner, every one of us in this room would side with him because we believe in freedom and liberty. Amen? Similarly, would we tell a black man who owns a catering business that he's got to provide the food and drink for a white supremacist conference? Would he not be able to deny service to them if it violated his conscience? Would he not? Is there anything the government or could force us to do, any service they could force us to perform at all, that we could possibly never say no to? You know what's ironic about that is when there was a crowdfunding campaign for Aaron and Melissa Klein, your crowdfunding campaign was canceled because it violated the terms of service of the organization that hosted the campaign. Is that not ironic? Let me bring in Sergeant Monk as we conclude our conversation here this evening, because you have a unique calling in this conversation, Philip, in that you took an oath. You are willing to lay down your life for the people that disagree with you, for people whose values you may not share. You are willing to do that as a soldier. Can you tell our audience what your story is and how that impacts and lets them know what's really going on with religious freedom in the military, which I think it's tragic enough what is happening to the average everyday people that are sitting up here. But now, Philip, we're going to tell those of you in uniform that you're not allowed to have the very freedoms that you're willing to lay down your life for. There's something even extra wrong about that.
That's right. And I will say right from the start, you call me today and I will drop everything, and I will go anywhere this country needs me, and I will put my life down for you, whether you're gay, straight, young, or old. We will do that. I'm just saying. But I will tell you, in the military right now, you cannot speak biblical truth about marriage. I come back from a deployment to an open lesbian commander, and she wants me and backs me into a corner and wants to know my views on marriage. And I will tell you this, if I'm backed into a corner between a major or my maker, I know where I'm going.
Amen.
If it's between a commander or my creator, I know where I'm going. And I'll tell you what, when I was deployed to Iraq, there was 600 traumas, 600 of our men and women that were fighting for their lives over there. And every one of them is over there thinking that they are preserving the freedoms right here in America. And probably the most heartbreaking conversation I had with one of those guys that returned was that he felt like in the 10 years, the 10 plus years we've been fighting overseas, the real war for America was happening right here. Amen.
We've got just a couple of minutes left. I want to go around rapid fire, take 20, 30 seconds. Final word of encouragement and or challenge to the people that are in the audience or watching this around the country. Melissa, I'll start with you.
Oh, gosh.
I'll let you go first. Get it over with.
That's not fair. Gosh, I guess, you know, for me, to encourage all of you, is I can tell you that before all of this happened,
your faith is always the right choice.
Amen. Sergeant?
If you're a service man or woman out there serving and you face something like this, I tell you what, you got a threefold avenue or way of going about it. The very first thing I would tell you is drop to your knees and pray to the great I Am that he will see you through. Two, call in reinforcements. You get on that phone, you dial Liberty Institute, and they're experts in this field. They're military experts. We'll join up with you, and then I will tell you, get off your knees and stand up and fight, because when you fight back, you win.
Amen. Now that is spoken like a soldier.
Yeah, no kidding. Well said.
Blaine, you get the last word.
Yeah, I think I want to speak directly to the youth, to the kids that are in this room. I want you guys to really listen to the stories that have been told tonight. Because, you know, you guys are the next generation. And the reality that hits home to me is that there's a cost. Just like I mentioned in that video about my kids, they're wrestling with this idea that if I sign up to follow Christ, there's a genuine cost in serving Him. And number two, don't ever substitute love for truth. They have to go together. Amen. Love and truth go together. So speak truth and love, and don't give up on that.
Ladies and gentlemen, tonight's heroes, give them a round of applause. This is the fundamental issue of this campaign. It is our first freedom. All our other freedoms derive from this. We can't have God-given rights if we can't have our God. Now, there is someone in this audience who, at the highest levels of government, in two of our three branches, has already shown that he will fight for these rights. He's done it in the judicial branch, all the way up to the U.S. Supreme Court. And he's won numerous cases that have helped keep our rights secured in this republic. And now he is doing it in the United States Senate. And the key thing, and the reason why I am supporting this gentleman, the number one reason, because this is a fine field, and you'll notice that the senator has been very gracious to all the people who have entered this race. It's a deep field. There are good candidates who morally would be more than qualified to be up on this stage here today. But there is one thing I think that sets Senator Cruz apart from everyone else. He understands that even more important than right versus left, it is right versus wrong. And that sometimes to preserve and defend those God-given rights, to honor that oath of office, to preserve and defend and protect this Constitution against all enemies, both foreign and domestic, means sometimes those domestic enemies are wearing your jersey. Sometimes they're on your own team. And that ultimately it is about what is best for the American people, not any political party, not any ideology. And that ultimately, when you take that oath of office, it is so help me God, not the media, not the political parties, not the polls, but so help me God. And that's why I'm going to ask you to join me in doing everything we can these next 5 months to see that he has the same opportunity to fight in the executive branch, in the White House, that he has shown both in the judicial and legislative branches in the U.S. Senate and before the U.S. Supreme Court. And let's make him the next president of the United States. Ladies and gentlemen, Senator Ted Cruz.
You were
Praise
fire,
God.
Man. You did good. You did good.
What incredible, powerful, moving testimonies. It is my hope that every man and woman in Iowa and that every man and woman across this country Listen to those stories. Listen to those stories. Understand these threats are not imagined. They're not made up. These are real people leading real lives who found themselves facing persecution simply for living out their faith. There is a war on faith in America today. In our lifetimes, did we ever imagine that in the land of the free and the home of the brave, we would be witnessing our government persecute its citizens for their faiths? We are blessed today to be in the presence of heroes who serve as an example to all of us of what it means to sacrifice for the kingdom. Heroes who have suffered for living out their faith and their personal convictions. Their stories are real and they're personal. Right here in Iowa, Dick and Betty Odegaard, forced to close down their wedding chapel because of their beliefs in the scriptural teachings of marriage. And in Washington, Baronelle Stutzman faced the same consequence for her courage after she and her flower shop had been sued. Aaron and Melissa Klein, their bakery in Oregon, and Blade Adamson's t-shirt business in Kentucky. Atlanta Fire Chief Kelvin Cochran, what a vision for God. And Senior Master Sergeant Philip Monk, who both, after lifetimes of service, were forced to depart their stations because of their faith. As Aaron Klein has said so powerfully, my fight in this situation is religious freedom. It is the ability to live and work by the dictates of my faith without being punished by the government, and all Americans should be free to do that. Think of the stories on this stage. These are people for whom right and truth will always mean more than going along to get along or looking the other way when right is replaced with what is wrong. These heroes have boldly resisted the state encroaching on their First Amendment rights. They have fought back against the Washington elite's war on faith, as have other heroes across the country, like the Little Sisters of the Poor, who have stood for faith, although the federal government is litigating against this Catholic charity to force nuns to pay for abortion-inducing drugs and others. Is it any surprise that the federal government we have today would use Obamacare to assault people of faith and to try to deprive them of their constitutional rights? We should ask ourselves, don't we need to know the full truth behind the administration's decision to come up with statutes and regulations discriminating against and persecuting people of faith? Don't we have a right to know about what government officials were involved in that process, what emails were sent, what outside groups were involved in making the decision that the federal government is now an enemy of the religious liberty rights of our citizens? We are seeing today an unprecedented assault on freedom, on faith, and especially on life and marriage. I don't have to remind anyone here of the atrocities committed each and every day by Planned Parenthood. These videos that have been made public make vivid what we already knew, that those who support them have demonstrated an utter disregard for human life. Innocent life should not be up for debate. An innocent life should not be treated as a business transaction. Selling the body parts of unborn children is a federal crime that carries with it 10 years in prison. And if I am elected president, I will instruct the U.S. Department of Justice to open an investigation into Planned Parenthood and prosecute any criminal action. Life is a precious gift from God. As Thomas Jefferson proclaimed, the God who gave us life gave us liberty. Once the government can take away the right to life, it can take away anything, even marriage. Just a few months ago, I appreciate your expressing your First Amendment rights, but the rule of law, and just a few months ago, we lived through the most tragic Supreme Court decision since Roe versus Wade. Five black robe lawyers attempted to redefine marriage for all 50 states. Justice Scalia wrote in his dissent, "The Supreme Court of the United States has descended from the disciplined legal reasoning of John Marshall and Joseph Story to the mystical aphorisms of the fortune cookie. The fortune cookie rules and the moral truths that have been evident to every civilization in recorded history have become declared obsolete." During the oral argument, we witnessed a frightening, although clarifying, exchange. Justice Samuel Alito asked the United States Solicitor General whether a university's tax-exempt status could be revoked, quote, if it opposed same-sex marriage. The Solicitor General's response was not reassuring. Quote, I don't deny that, Justice Alito. It is going to be an issue. The tax-exempt status of Christian universities, of Christian grade schools, of Christian charities, and even of the church itself is, quote, going to be an issue because a federal ruling that denies the definition of marriage as the union of one man and one woman could easily be used as a pretext to prosecute and persecute anyone who believes in the scriptural teaching and biblical understanding of marriage. You listen to these incredible, brave stories up here and you wonder, is the next victim of persecution your pastor standing at the pulpit on Sunday morning? Is it the grade school that your little girls go to? Is it the charity where you volunteer your time at a crisis pregnancy center? We have descended from an attack on life to marriage, and now from marriage to religious liberty. Because it's not enough for these advocates to tear down marriage. Now the Washington elites want to silence those who believe in the biblical definition of marriage. Their goal is to keep people of faith from being able to live by the dictates of their conscience and to freely express their beliefs. The tactic we have heard over and over again is to bully people of faith into silence. How many of these heroes told stories of people saying, I'm with you, but only in secret, because I cannot stand the condemnation that comes if I stand with you in the light of day. Religious freedom is and always has been central to the American experience. It cuts across class lines, racial lines, ethnic lines, party lines. It unifies us. It is who we are as an American people. I'm reminded of a line from the movie The Usual Suspects. The greatest trick the devil ever played was to convince the world he didn't exist. I will suggest a corollary. The greatest trick the left has ever played is to convince conservatives that Americans don't share our values. America is and remains a center-right country. We are and remain a country built on Judeo-Christian values. That is who the American people are. And we here today must renew our resolve to protect our God-given rights from all of those eager to try to take them away. We gather today here in the heartland of America to take a stand against religious bigotry and intolerance, and for those brave heroes who have lost their livelihoods and their positions of honor by standing for faith. This rally is a chance to stand for freedom and for the idea that rights don't come from black robe lawyers or from politicians in Washington. They come from God. It is this understanding, it is this revelation that has made America an exceptional nation and indeed the exceptional nation in the history of the world. Now is the time for each of us to ask for the courage of Daniel and Esther and Jeremiah. This is about freedom-loving people of faith versus those who want to silence our faith and take away our freedom. History shows us that in order to gain control of the people, you must first destroy their moral fiber, destroy their faith. But what scares the extremists the most is that there are more of us than there are of them. You have heard tonight of two tremendous groups, the Liberty Institute and the Alliance Defending Freedom, two groups I have been proud to volunteer, to work with, to support for many, many decades. And let me tell you, these groups, if you are finding yourself persecuted for your faith, these groups exist to defend our First Amendment rights, our religious liberty. They have lawyers on call that will come often and represent you for free because they believe and understand if we lose our religious liberty, we lose every freedom in America. Many of you know my father, Raphael, is a pastor. He saw freedom taken away in Cuba, and it breaks his heart to see the same thing happening in America. My father travels around the country. He's 76 years old, and he's on the road 7 days a week with the energy of a teenager. And he delivers a tough message, especially to fellow pastors. And that he stands and addresses pastors and tells them, if you look at the plight of the nation, no one bears more responsibility than the pastors. If the flock stumbles in a ditch, you don't blame the sheep. You blame the shepherd. In this country right now, there are roughly 90 million evangelical Christians. In the last election, 54 million evangelicals stayed home. 54 million. You wonder why we have a federal government that comes after our free speech rights, that comes after our religious liberty, that comes after life, that comes after marriage, that comes after our values. It is because 54 million evangelical Christians stayed home. Well, I'm here to tell you, we will stay home no longer. I'd like to ask every pastor who is here with us today to please stand. Thank you. Thank you for your leaderships. Thank you for standing for faith. Thank you for the impact you're making in your congregation, in your community, standing up together, helping all of us awaken the body of Christ to restore this nation. We are building an alliance of pastors with a pastor and faith leader in each of the 99 counties across the state of Iowa. Together, we will stand up and we will show up. We are a self-governing people, and we will defend our liberty. We will not be shut out because we still hold truths to be self-evident. We will not be silent. We will not take court rulings as a mandate to forget our faith while Washington elites try to force their values upon us. That is why I am so incredibly grateful for the thousands who have come out today, for the home groups and church groups across Iowa and across this country. It gives all of us hope that what has been lost in our nation's capital is alive in the hearts of those who believe. And I give you my solemn word. If I am elected president, on my first day in office, I will instruct the Department of Justice and the IRS and every federal agency in Washington that the persecution of religious liberty ends today. Like the Newsboys' song, God's Not Dead. Which we'll be hearing very soon. Neither is America and her love of freedom and our people's willingness to defend our freedom. A nation willing to subject itself to the tyranny of man's standard is not worthy to be called a free nation. And to show all of us where this can go, we've seen the persecution here at home. We've seen Sergeant Monk's powerful testimony of our soldiers fighting for us who said the real battle was being waged here at home. And yet it is worth remembering that it can still get much, much worse. As horrific as the persecution is growing here at home, Christians across the globe are facing torture and murder, are facing imprisonment. And what I'd like to do now is recognize one more hero that I've grown to respect and to admire, the wife of Pastor Saeed Abedini. Name Abedini. Name, welcome. I'm so glad you could be here with us
and
stand for our faith. Would you please tell us about Pastor Saeed?
Well, first time in Des Moines, so glad to be here with Senator Cruz, one of my favorite people. He's a great dad, and I was watching you with your beautiful daughters, and it's heartbreaking. His kids have missed his embrace for over 3 years. He won't back down on his faith in Jesus Christ. He's been tortured and beaten. He's been in prison for 3 years now.
He was moved from prison to prison because he's not only not denied his faith, but he's shared his faith with those in prison with him. So, he's in the hands of the hardliners, and they are angry. They've told our government officials that he hasn't learned his lesson. Not only does he not deny his faith in Jesus Christ, but he tells other people about it, and that's the way he shows his love. That's the way Saeed, he found life in Christ. He used to be a Muslim and found Christ, and he's a passionate follower of Christ.
So many of you here know the story of Pastor Saeed. He's an American citizen. He and his wife and two beautiful children. His family resides in Idaho. But Pastor Saeed traveled to Iran and was sentenced to 8 years in prison for the crime of preaching the gospel. It's been 3 years he's been locked up in an Iranian prison. As we think about the threats we face here, it's a powerful reminder of what can happen. Tell us about Saeed as a husband and a father.
Well, before he went to Iran, he would usually open his suitcase, because we were working on an orphanage, and he would tell the kids, bring your toys and clothes so I can take it to the orphans. And they would bring their old toys and clothes, and he would say, nope, go get that toy you got for Christmas, go get that clothes that you love so much. And they would come, and they were so young. My daughter was five now, she will be nine soon, and my son was four the last time they saw him. And they would cry and bring their favorite toys. And I would get mad thinking, why would you do this to the kids? But he would say, you always give God your best. You don't give your, you know. He was always trying to instill Christian values in them and teach them, and he poured into them the first few years of their life that they still carry with them. My daughter will be nine next month, and she was five when she last saw him. And it's heartbreaking, because a few weeks ago I noticed she stopped drawing Saeed and the family when she draws family pictures.
Mm.
And I think it's a way of just, she's given up hope that he will come. She's hoped every birthday that this would be the birthday. And this year I notice, as it gets closer to her birthday, she wrote family, and she just draws me and them. And I think it's just become a coping mechanism for them to say, you know what, this is life with mommy, and this is how it's going to be. And I just tell them to trust Jesus, and that we serve a good God. And if things don't work out on our timeline or the way we want to, God's goodness is not questioned. Someone shared up here that when their faith was tested, they actually grew stronger. That's how I feel my faith with God, that actually when I hit rock bottom, I discovered Christ in a more intimate way, and found him. You know, I could never question God's goodness. I've actually discovered it. So I'm grateful for that.
When Pastor Saeed was first sent to prison, he was sent to the Evin prison, a brutal prison in Iran. But it turned out for the Ayatollah that was not good enough, and they transferred Pastor Saeed to the even worse Rajai Shahr prison, which is where they keep their death row. It is the worst hellhole in the entire Iranian prison system. The day they transferred Pastor Saeed was a day that the Iranian Ayatollah celebrates. It's a holiday in Iran. It's called Death to America Day. It is the anniversary of Iran's taking American citizens hostages in the 1970s. And the Ayatollah leads chants of Death to America while they burn American flags, That was the day they transferred Pastor Saeed to this prison. How is his health holding up? How is he doing?
Well, I have to say they don't like him because he represents America, but also because he represents Jesus Christ. And those are two things that the radical who are holding him do not like about him. He's not doing very well. I wish I could say he was. He's in one of the worst prisons in the world. The beatings he endured the first month was pretty horrible. He was put in solitary. He's been put in and out of solitary 3 or 4 times now, and they've never treated it. Doctors have said he needs surgery, and he was hospitalized last year, but Iranian government refuses to treat him, and part of their torture is to allow him to suffer in his pain every day.
And yet, in the face of this darkness, one of the most extraordinary things is that from that Iranian prison cell, Pastor Saeed has led numerous of his fellow prisoners and his captors to Christ. Name, we know that God has it in his power to free Saeed from prison. Just as Paul and Silas, an earthquake shattered open the prison, and they walked out with their captors ready to take his own life in God's power. Know that today, right now, Saeed is not alone in that prison. And you and your children are not alone as your husband is suffering. Every one of us here, we are lifting you up in prayer. We are standing with you. Your faith, your steadfastness, your courage, and your love, they inspire every one of us. God's love shines from you. I'd like to give everyone an opportunity to see a video that Name's and Saeed's children made for their father. We could play the video.
Dear President Obama, please help bring my daddy home. I miss him so much. I want my daddy to bring me to Disneyland for my birthday. I don't want to miss another birthday without him. I don't want him to miss another birthday or Christmas or Father's Day. Please help bring him home. Why does our daddy need to be in prison for loving Jesus?
Stay with us one moment. I'd like to say something very, very clearly. President Obama, bring Pastor Saeed home. Before we wrap up and welcome the newsboys to to this stage for the concert. I'd like to invite each of the heroes to come back to the stage. And I want to close this portion of the program in prayer as we stand together. So I would welcome each of the heroes who shared your stories to please come join us here. And let me say to the folks who are at home, to the folks who are watching on live stream, to the folks who are watching in home groups or church groups, I would encourage you to please come sign our national petition in defense of religious liberty. It's at the website, tedcruz.org, tedcruz.org. Or you can text the word liberty to the number 41444. Tonight, we have seen with these incredible heroes what it means to speak the truth to a world that sometimes refuses to listen to the truth. We have seen what it means to suffer for it both here at home and abroad. All of us must stand for truth. And I would ask each of us to pray together for these heroes and for our nation. And if we would all stand, pray. Father God, we come to you today on our knees, celebrating your glory, celebrating the courage and faith of these heroes who follow the teachings of the Word, who reflect in their countenance the redeeming love of our Savior, Jesus Christ. And Father God, we come here today claiming the promises of the Scripture. Jesus told us, He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed. Jesus also said, But whoever denies me before men, Him I will also deny before my Father who is in heaven. In Galatians 5:1, it tells us, Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty by which Christ has made us free, and do not be entangled again with a yoke of bondage. Jesus told us, Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. We claim that promise tonight, Father God. Galatians 6:2 tells us, Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. These heroes are not standing alone. They are standing surrounded by hedges of protection, with prayer warriors and intercessors in this room, across this state, across this nation, across the world. The body of Christ is standing together, celebrating their courage and praying for peace on their families, praying for the peace that passes all understanding. Father God, we claim the promise of Psalms 35 that tells us weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. We claim that promise together. We celebrate and we thank you for your everlasting love. We thank you for the purifying, sanctifying blood of Jesus Christ. And we thank you for this great nation in which we live, for the religious liberty that each of us is guaranteed under our Constitution. And we pray that you awaken the body of Christ across this nation, that believers and lovers of liberty, that we stand together to reclaim this nation. We thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
I'm the leading state sponsor of terrorism.